As we gather for public worship, please take your hymnal and turn to hymn 391. 391, safely through another week. Let's begin our worship praising our God. Hymn 391. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
It's good to see you again. Good to be with you again. Welcome to our worship at Covenanters. As we have just sung, we have great expectations for today. Great expectations as we gather to worship our God. Our expectation is in Him. Our help is in Him, and He will certainly provide for us and bless us as we petition Him according to His will. This is the day He's given to minister to us in a particular way. This is the day and the time, the hour when He comes to meet with us in a particular way. And we can trust that He will come, for He is our God who has made that way possible through both the work of Jesus Christ and the promises that are fulfilled in Christ. As we gather for worship this morning, we look forward to hearing God's word proclaimed. This is a dialogue in worship where God speaks to us. He'll call us into worship in the next few moments, and then we respond all the way until He really dismisses us with His blessing and we sing His praise. After our worship this morning, we'll have our time of fellowship and refreshments, and then we will have a time of sermon discussion, and Sunday school will meet for the two youngest classes for the last time this calendar year. So that will take place after our morning worship. And then this afternoon, we gather again for worship at 4:30, and we are going to be in Galatians 4 and considering the question, why did Jesus come into the world? Why did Jesus come into the world? And trust you'll find a glorious truth, a glorious answer to that question as God speaks to us in His Word. Let's take a few moments now as we prepare for this worship service with some silent prayer, asking the Lord to be with us, to bless us together as His people, and to enable us to worship Him in spirit and in truth. Brothers and sisters, please stand as you're able. We hear God call us to worship from Psalm 47, both this morning and again this afternoon. Oh, clap your hands, all you peoples. Shout to God with a voice of triumph. For the Lord Most High is awesome. He is a great king over all the earth. He will subdue the peoples under us and the nations under our feet. He will choose our inheritance for us, the excellence of Jacob, whom he loves. God has gone up with a shout, the Lord with the sound of a trumpet. Sing praises to God, sing praises. Sing praises to our King, sing praises. For God is the King of all the earth. Sing praises with understanding. Let's pray. Lord, we bless you and praise your name, and we do want to lift up our voices and shout with triumph. For in your work and through King Jesus, we do have victory. We come to worship you and give you thanks for that victory you've given us in salvation. Lord, a victory that is certain and sure in Christ. And Lord, we thank you that we can come and worship you for it. Lord, we thank you for Jesus Christ, whom you have put on the throne. He who has come into this world, has accomplished his work, and has gone up with a shout into heaven, and has been received and placed upon at your right hand. And Lord, to him he has received all the inheritance you've promised him for his work well done. To him all the nations have been given, and he rules and reigns and accomplishes his purposes. He calls out those whom you've given to him. He saves them. And Lord, he establishes his church. We thank you for it. Lord, we thank you for the dominion that he has and the rule that he exercises. Lord, we thank you and we praise you and we sing hallelujah. Lord, in a particular way, we know he cares for us as his church. Lord, we do not need to be afraid of any of his or our enemies. We do not need to be afraid of all of them put together. But Lord, we come in the great and powerful name of Jesus who has won the victory and we can stand secure. Lord, we come here to be reminded of that he has done, to be encouraged in our walk and our service, in our Christian living, and Lord, to also in the battles we fight, to do so in the power of Jesus Christ, to be strengthened in that. So Lord, today as your people, we gather in confidence, we gather with thanksgiving that we can know you and know such a salvation. We pray, O Lord, that now in our worship, we would attend to you with undivided devotion. We pray that our hearts would not be far from you and we draw near to you with our mouths and honor you with our lips, but that with all that we do, it would be from the heart out a genuine and true praise of you. So as you speak to us, may we receive it in faith. As we respond to you, may we do so also with faith, with joy, and with a true heart of devotion. We commit this to you and we commit this service to your name for your honor. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's take your hymnal again and we'll sing hymn 225. Hymn 225, Once in Royal David City.
Thank you.
seated. Open the Bible, open our Bibles to Matthew chapter 22, verse 35 to 40. For the revelation of God's will, and then we will follow that with a corporate confession of our sin and a seeking of the grace of God as we gather as God's people into the holy presence of God. It is good for us to confess our sin. This is how we live our lives, a life of daily repentance and daily of seeking the grace of God so that we would be less prone to sin and evil and more conformed to the image of Christ who lived that perfect life. But we come, of course, as we hear these words to seek the Lord's strength as well so that we would live a holy life because it's only by Him and through Him that we can do so. And we can genuinely do so in Christ. Well, let's hear then the command of our Lord as we come to Matthew 22. Then one of them, a lawyer, asked Him a question, testing Him and saying, "Teacher, which is the great commandment in the law?" And Jesus said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." Well, as we confess our sin, let's seek from God the grace to love Him so that we would obey Him and follow Him as He tells us we ought to do. Let's pray. Lord our God, as we come to You in worship, it is good for us to confess our sin. It is good to openly confess our struggles against the flesh, the desires of our sinful heart that are not yet conformed to Your will, that, Lord, are still striving to have a separate will, a different will, to have a different way of living. Lord, the self-love that still wants to dominate. Lord, we come to confess our sin, not because mere confession does anything. It's You who makes the difference. You make the difference when we come to confess our sin and we come in the promises that You will change our hearts. You will correct our sin and our ways of sin. You will continue that work that You've begun. You will forgive us for what we have done. Lord, it is good to bring to You our struggles with the evil one, to confess how his temptations still do appeal to us all too often. It's good to acknowledge our discontented Christian living in a world that too often seems so much more attractive and promises such seemingly wonderful things. It's good again to confess our sin because from You comes forgiveness. And from You comes the change we need. The change we need so that we would be more drawn to You, have a greater passion and a hunger after Your righteousness, a greater desire to know more about You, a greater longing to be dwelling in Your presence, Lord, and less of a reliance on ourselves to fight against sin and evil, less of a reliance on our own abilities to discern what is good and what we need and what is good for us, Lord, apart from what You declare in Your Word and what You tell us. Lord, from You comes the strength we need, the renewed strength to fight the good fight of faith and love as we ought to love. By You, O God, we can have our eyes open to see through the schemes of Satan and the false promises of the world. Lord, together as the church, as we pray together, we are reminded of Your promised strength, so that we can fight together for the sake and the cause of the kingdom of Jesus Christ, and that we are not alone in our confession. Certainly, Lord, we're not alone in our confession, for we come in Christ's name. Even as we open our mouths and we confess our sin, O God, it is not us against You, Lord, but this is the means You've given so we can be reconciled, and You've given us Christ to be our mediator, to be our advocate, to be the one who pleads at Your right hand for us and offers Himself in our place for our sin. So we're never alone in confession, for Christ is with us. We are never alone in temptation. We can resist by the power of the Spirit of Christ that is in us, that is present in us. The same, Lord, that we can follow by His power the path that He took of saying no to temptation. And Lord, we will never be forsaken by You, our Heavenly Father. So we can openly confess our sin, receive Your forgiveness, share our need with You, and seek Your help. You are not one who despises the little ones who come to You and pray for help and strength, to confess weakness and to confess sin. But You are the one, Lord, who delights to receive us as we humbly confess our sins, that you can forgive us and strengthen us to live more faithfully for you. Lord, you do not, you are not pleased with those who would hide their sin, who would pretend to be strong all by themselves, who would imagine that they can live a good life without you. But you are well pleased in those who acknowledge we are weak and we come to you for strength. And by your power, we do make progress in the Christian life, and we do live in holiness, and we do and are able to do what is right and pleasing. Lord, so we come now, what we do and is what we do through the great Savior, Jesus Christ, we do confess our sin. And by faith, Lord, we receive your forgiveness. And we share our needs with you, Lord, and seek your help and your strength. So God, we pray, forgive us and help us as we look to you in faith in this hour. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Over and over again in the Scriptures, we have the promise that God of God to those who confess their sin, he will freely, justly, and wonderfully forgive our sin. That's a promise we need to hold to and cling to. So often we can still think, well, I've confessed my sin, but I just don't feel forgiven. But God doesn't say it's about how you feel. He said it's what's true. And we need to take the objective statements of God's word that when we confess our sin, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sin, or else we deny the work of Christ and the effect of Christ. But we have words of promise and we have words of comfort. And that's what we have here, having confessed our sin and trusting in Christ from Isaiah 40. Comfort, yes, comfort my people, says your God. Speak comfort to Jerusalem and cry out to her that her warfare is ended, that her iniquity is pardoned, for she has received from the Lord's hand double for all our sins. If we ever doubt the generosity of our God, recognize that he pays back our sin with double the comfort and the blessing and the grace. That where sin abounds, grace does much, much, much more abound. And thanks be to God. That is his free gift to us in Jesus Christ. That is our confidence and hope as we confess our sin. He has indeed forgiven and does so much more. Well, let's sing, let's give thanks to our God and respond to his great gifts to us, not to match what he's done for us, but to give in thanksgiving our tithes and our offerings in service to him. Now let's respond to God's grace to us with singing praise. Hymn 48, O Lord Most High, with all my heart. And we'll stand to sing.
Your wondrous works I wear.
be seated. Please open your scriptures to Isaiah 35 for our Old Testament reading. Isaiah 35, which is a prophecy of the work that Jesus Christ would do to restore His church, to build His church, and to usher in the new covenant. And then we're going to see something of that fulfillment in Luke chapter 7. And the coming of the Christ and the joy it would bring and the change it would bring. We read this in Isaiah 35. The wilderness and the wasteland shall be glad for them, and the desert shall rejoice and blossom as the rose. It shall blossom abundantly and rejoice, even with joy and singing. The glory of Lebanon shall be given to it. The excellence of Carmel and Sharon, they shall see the glory of the Lord, the excellency of our God. Strengthen the weak hands and make firm the feeble knees. Say to those who are fearful-hearted, be strong, do not fear. Behold, your God will come with vengeance. With the recompense of God, He will come and save you. Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened, and the ears of the deaf shall be unstopped. Then the lame shall leap like a deer, and the tongue of the dumb sing. For waters shall burst forth in the wilderness, and streams in the desert. The parched ground shall become a pool, and the thirsty land springs of water. In the land, in the habitation of jackals, where each lay, there shall be grass with reeds and rushes. A highway shall be there, and a road, and it shall be called the highway of holiness. The unclean shall not pass over it, but it shall be for others. Whoever walks the road, although a fool, shall not go astray. No lion shall be there, nor shall any ravenous beast go up on it. It shall not be found there, but the redeemed shall walk there. And the ransomed of the Lord shall return and come to Zion with singing, with everlasting joy on their heads. They shall obtain joy and gladness, and sorrow and sighing shall flee away. Let's turn then to Luke 7. We're going to read verses 11 to 35, but focus in on verses 18 to 23. Now it happened the day after that Jesus went into a city called Nain, and many of his disciples went with him, and a large crowd. And when he came near the gate of the city, behold, a dead man was being carried out, the only son of his mother, and she was a widow. And a large crowd from the city was with her. And when the Lord saw her, he had compassion on her and said to her, "Do not weep." Then he came and touched the open coffin, and those who carried him stood still. And he said, "Young man, I say to you, arise." So he who was dead sat up and began to speak, and he presented him to his mother. Then fear came upon all, and they glorified God, saying, "A great prophet has risen up among us, and God has visited his people." And this report about him went throughout all Judea and all the surrounding region. Then the disciples of John reported to him concerning all these things. And John, calling two of his disciples to him, sent them to Jesus, saying, "Are you the coming one, or do we look for another?" And when the men had come to him, they said, "John the Baptist has sent us to you, saying, 'Are you the coming one, or do we look for another?'" And that very hour, he cured many of infirmities, afflictions, and evil spirits, and to many blind, he gave sight. Jesus answered and said to them, "Go and tell John the things you have seen and heard. That the blind see, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, the poor have the gospel preached to them. And blessed is he who is not offended because of me." When the messengers of John had departed, he began to speak to the multitudes concerning John. "What did you go out into the wilderness to see? A reed shaken by the wind? But what did you go out to see? A man clothed in soft garments? Indeed, those who are gorgeously appareled and live in luxury are in king's courts. But what did you go out to see? A prophet? Yes, I say to you, and more than a prophet, this is he of whom it is written, behold, I send my messenger before your face who will prepare your way before you. For I say to you, among those born of women, there is not a greater prophet than John the Baptist. But he who is least in the kingdom of God is greater than he. And when all the people heard him, even the tax collectors justified God, having been baptized with the baptism of John. But the Pharisees and lawyers rejected the will of God for themselves, not having been baptized by him. And the Lord said, to what then shall I liken the men of this generation? And what are they like? They are like children sitting in the marketplace and calling to one another, saying, we played the flute for you, and you did not dance. We mourned to you, and you did not weep. For John the Baptist came neither eating bread nor drinking wine, and you say, he has a demon. The Son of Man has come eating and drinking, and you say, look, a glutton and a winebibber, a friend of tax collectors and sinners. But wisdom is justified by all her children. Let's ask the Lord to bless us, to pour out his grace upon us as we hear his word proclaimed. Let's pray. Lord God, we have read in Isaiah of how the coming of the Christ has turned wilderness settings and desert scenes into lush and wonderful places of beautiful plants and flowers, has taken that which is brown and made it green and alive. And so, Lord, we ask that you do the same today. If there are any hearts here that are not walking with you, whether it's still wilderness and desert, that you would change those hearts and fill them with Christ, and that, Lord, they too would bring forth great fruit and show, Lord, the new life that you have, that you give them. We ask, O God, that you would work in all of our hearts, for we all, Lord, need the outpouring of truth into our hearts, of the Spirit, for the Spirit to apply your word into our lives. And so we pray that you would do that mighty work. And so equip me in the Spirit to preach, and for all of us to hear and believe and live. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Did you see in the news recently there was a story of a man who on his deathbed confessed to his daughter that he was not actually who he said he was, that he actually, his real name was a different name, but he was a bank robber on the run for 5 decades, had never been caught, and now that he was dying of cancer, he thought it was a good time to confess that this was true. And so the name she had, the last name she carried, all of it was false. It was fake. He was someone different. He couldn't bear to tell his wife this, and so she did, his daughter did, after she had gone home, went on the internet with the real name and found all these news stories and very quickly connected the dots and realized what her dad had told her was absolutely true, that he was a bank robber, a fugitive from the law since 1969. Imagine a revelation like that would leave you with a lot of questions. A lot of questions. And make you doubt everything you've known in your life. Make you wonder what actually is true. Even those things that were once solid and you thought, this is, I know this to be true. Now everything, it's like the whole foundation of your life, of what you thought you knew about your family, all of it's gone. And it's interesting, as you read that story, that the daughter, this happened a couple years ago now, but the story came out recently, and the daughter talks about how they worked through some of these things, including having to, the police coming to realize, make the connection after her father had died and coming to their door. You can understand, there's a lot of understandable doubt that comes up in such a situation. Well, this morning, we talk about doubt. Doubt about one's identity. Doubt about the identity of Jesus Christ. Is Jesus who he says he is? Is Jesus really the Messiah? Is Jesus the one that you and I ought to be putting our hope in? And these are doubts that come to us via the doubts that John the Baptist was struggling with, that he had in his heart. Not because Jesus had lied, not because Jesus had his life not because there was anything truly wrong with his life, that his life somehow didn't match what he talked about, or that Jesus had done something to stir these doubts, but yet the doubts that John had were still very real in his own mind and heart. He was wondering. He had questions that needed answering. as he struggled, as his foundation for what he understood about the Messiah was being shaken. Perhaps, can you relate to John and the doubts that he had? Even perhaps in struggle and trials when your life isn't going the direction you thought it would. That because you're in Jesus, you thought it's going to go this way, but it's not going this way. Is Jesus who he says he is? Even in difficulties. Now perhaps you struggle to admit you have doubts. Because you think, well, I can't admit I have doubts. Because if I have doubts, isn't that just going to make the doubts worse? Almost we just pretend. We ignore it. We just pretend it's not real. And hopefully then we'll forget about them. Instead, if we admit it, then it might make it too real. But you see, brothers and sisters, the scriptures don't say stuff down your questions. Stuff down your doubts. Just jam them down deep into your soul. And hopefully then you'll just forget they exist. But the scriptures say take your doubts to Jesus. Come to the truth of the Word of God. Come to find Jesus in the Scriptures and to discover that He is who He says He is. He will speak to you through His Word and by His Spirit, giving you that understanding that yes, He is the Son of God. He is the Savior of sinners. He is the long-promised Messiah who has come. He is your only hope in life and in death. And indeed, that hope in life and death is something certainly we've been considering. Even last time we were in Luke some weeks ago, that Jesus right there is that hope not only in life, but also even in death, even as he raised that dead boy in Nain, not only comforting that mother, not only giving her a son to provide and help her for the time being until, again, she and he would die again, but to demonstrate, I am the one whom God has promised to send. Well, that report about Jesus, as the people wondered, who is this man? That report was spreading throughout all of Israel, and it was coming even into the dungeon where John the Baptist was languishing. And he was hearing the message. He was hearing about this Jesus. He was hearing about what he's preached and what he was doing and the report, however many people it had gone through before it had gone to him, perhaps. It was a direct report from his disciples, or they had heard it from someone else, but here whatever it was, there's some doubt in his own heart. And as we consider both his doubt and Jesus' gracious and comforting response to his doubt, so we can learn more about our Lord and how we ought to, in our own lives, deal with the struggles that we have in our Christian life, in our Christian thinking, any doubts that we may have in our hearts right now, or may come to us as we walk the Christian life. In all your moments of doubt, look to Jesus and his works in order to live in faith. In all your moments of doubt, look to Jesus and his works in order to live in faith. We're going to first consider your moments of doubt, verses 18 and 19. Then look to the Lord and his works in verses 20 to 22. And then we're going to conclude with this exhortation to live in faith and the promised blessing that Jesus gives us. Now, first, your moments of doubt. As Jesus was doing these miracles, particularly after he raised the dead, we read in the previous verses that the great fear came upon all of them. They glorified God and they said, a great prophet has come among us and the Lord has visited his people. There was, in a sense, some messianic hope, but yet not a declaration. The best they could say was that Jesus was a great prophet, but they weren't yet looking to him as the Messiah. But this report and these questions were going around and they were spreading far and wide, including down further south along the Dead Sea to a place called Machaerus, which was which was where Herod lived. His fortress was his palace, and there in that fortress was a prison, and in that prison was John the Baptist. So Josephus tells us that's where John was put in prison and would eventually lose his life. And there in that prison, apparently where John was, yet it was known as a horrific place, and yet John was still also able to receive visitors. And so he had those of his disciples, those who had followed him and who were still loyal to him, as in they cared about him, they cared about their teacher, and they were coming and they were visiting with him. And as they came, they brought with them this report. Even there, into that place, this report about Jesus was coming. And they were, whatever they were exactly reporting to him, it caused John to want to send two of his disciples back, send them to Jesus with questions. He sends them, he calls two of his disciples and sends them with this question, are you the coming one or do we look for another? In other words, are you the Messiah? Are you the promised one that God was going to send? Are you the fulfillment of these prophecies? Or are we to look for someone else who is still yet to come? And this question may astonish us and may trouble us, actually. Is this the same John who preached a message of repentance, preparing the way of the Lord, saying that, yes, I baptize you with water, but there's one coming after me who's going to baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. He's going to bring judgment if you don't repent and submit to God. Is this the same John who, when Jesus came to him, said, I shouldn't baptize you, you should baptize me, and then was a witness to the Trinity, affirming the work of Christ and the call of the ministry of Christ as the Father spoke from heaven, declaring Jesus to be his beloved Son, as the Holy Spirit descended upon Christ in the appearance of a dove, as Jesus was there in the water, John witnessed these things. Is this the same John asking this question? Is this the same John who, to his disciples, pointed to Jesus and said, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And they left and followed him. They followed Jesus. Is this the same John? Now there are some commentators, some good commentators, who would say, look, John isn't sending this message on his behalf. What he's doing is he's sending his disciples because he wants them to see this is the Messiah. He's asking that question so they would go to Jesus, they would see who hear Jesus and see his works, and they would believe just like John does. That John's faith is rock solid, but it's his disciples who need to detach from John and attach themselves to Jesus. And it's admittedly an attractive idea and a thought. It's one that I've over the years have thought about and have found intriguing, but yet as I've studied it more this week and done some other reading on it, I don't think that's what is going on here. I think this doubt is genuinely John's doubt. One, because John is not normally indirect. John is a pretty direct person. I think if he wanted to tell his disciples, this is the Messiah, go follow him and leave me alone, he would have told them, go follow him and leave me alone. And the other thing is that Jesus' response, his tender, comforting, kind response, is directed at John, directed for John. And Jesus very graciously not only sends a message back to John, but even after those disciples leave, Jesus speaks well of John, speaks highly of John, and is careful to say, though he's sending comfort and encouraging John, yet that doesn't mean that John's whole faith is all in shambles and gone, that this was a faithful messenger of the Lord. So I think it is true. John had an incredibly strong faith and a bold witness, and he was courageous for the gospel. And as so far as he understood it, having not yet seen the fullness of Christ's work, but yet even one as strong as John can still have doubts. He can still have doubts, and I think that is what is happening here. He still had these doubts and had a need for Jesus Christ to rest in him in the present moment, not in some past experience. Not looking back to say, well, this is what I did back then, but to say, I need this fresh comfort and encouragement of Christ. I need my faith to be encouraged and strengthened now. And understand this for both John and for your own life, that there is a vast difference between struggling with doubts and refusing to believe. There's a vast difference between struggling with doubt and refusing to believe. Someone who struggles with doubt is someone who wants to be grounded in Christ, someone who wants to be certain of the gospel of Jesus Christ, wants those questions that have come up from one circumstance or someone else has asked a question, now you're wondering. They want to know the truth. They want to be firm in Christ versus someone who hears the truth, sees the truth in Christ, and does not want to believe. Does not want to hear it, is refusing, is stubbornly saying, no, I want another Savior. I'm looking for another Savior. Jesus isn't enough. There's a vast difference. As you struggle with doubts in your own life, and the evil one might attack your heart and say, ha, yeah, what are you? Some good Christian you are, having a doubt about Jesus. It's a vast difference to say, Lord, I want to believe. I want to be strengthened in my faith. I believe, help my unbelief. Help my doubts. give me the grace that I'm grounded in Christ, that whatever the weakness of the flesh is, I'll find my strength in Jesus. John, you know, we can speculate to some degree about what might have caused his doubts. We're not told what had stirred John's doubts. Of course, being in prison, these were not, you know, this was not a nice white-collar jail. Not that I don't know if any prison is great, but you know, this was not one where things were just, were all fine and clean and the meals, three square meals a day, and everything was relatively comfortable. Certainly being thrown into prison, he goes from being a preacher that was well-regarded to being thrown into prison because he had been courageous to preach against Herod, to preach against the wickedness of Herod, who took his brother's wife to be his own, and Herod threw him into prison. There's John languishing, perhaps wondering, well, if Jesus is who he says he is, welcome, maybe there's that question that has creeped into his heart. I'm still in prison. Is he going to rescue me? Perhaps John is wondering, wait, I'm hearing lots about the message of preaching of the kingdom and the call of people to come and believe and the message of grace and the comfort that this one is bringing and healing many. And where's the judgment I preached? Where's the coming judgment? I said this one would come and baptize with the Holy Spirit and with fire, and yet I don't hear about the judgment. And John was a hard preacher. Now, he was a righteous preacher. He preached well, but perhaps wondering, where is the fulfillment? Is this the one? I thought he was supposed to bring this judgment. And yes, he would. But perhaps John had a misunderstanding of how that all would be. But at the end of it, John also no doubt realized that his life was going to come to an end, probably sooner rather than later. And perhaps he wanted, as he struggled, and he wanted to know, have I put my hope in the right one? Have I rested in the right Messiah? Is this the true Messiah? Whatever those situations might be, maybe it's a mix of those things, maybe it's something else completely. John was struggling with doubt. And perhaps those are struggles you can look at we can think about. Maybe this is what John was thinking. But if you're struggling with doubt in your own life, you can perhaps look at it and think, well, I can put my finger on more, not less. I can put my finger on what I'm struggling with. Maybe not what John's struggling with exactly, but what I'm struggling with. Is God, I look around at the world around me, is God really in control? Does Jesus really have dominion over the world? Is the way that God is working in the world, is that really the best way? Should I be trusting in this one? Why is my life so hard when I'm a Christian? Why does everyone else's life seem to be so easy and mine seems to be so hard? Does God really mean it when he says he loves me? Especially when we still see sin in our own life and think, well, God couldn't possibly love me the way he says. Is Jesus really true when he says he loves me? Look at these rapid changes in my life. Things seem to be going one direction, and all of a sudden they seem to be going another direction. Things seem to be stable and fine and relatively happy, and even on that nice slight increase, things are just progressing along, and all of a sudden the brakes get slammed on. I'm going downhill the wrong direction. There's all sorts of changes. Maybe it's my job. Maybe it's my family. Maybe it's whatever. Maybe it's my health. And it's all at once. Perhaps these are the struggles that stir the doubts in your own heart. And you look at someone like John, and if you had put together a list of those who would be most likely to doubt Jesus that were around him, John would not be on the top of the list. But yet his doubt was real, his struggle was real, and so was yours if you're dealing with these troubles. But what you need to do is not just stay there in the struggles, but follow the way of John. That is, look to Jesus, send for Jesus, go to Jesus in your every moment of doubt that you have. That's what John does. He does the right thing. In all your moments of doubt, like John, look to Jesus and his works in order to live in faith. We go then from doubt to deliverance. From doubt to deliverance as we follow John's disciples to Jesus. Have you ever been doubted by someone? Unjustly. Someone has questioned whether you're loyal. Someone has questioned whether you're right. Someone has questioned whether or not that what you say is the best, is wise, is true. Well, Jesus is doubted here by one of those whom he would have been closest to him, at least in relationship from his early years, and a relative of his. John questions him. Jesus receives the questioning, and yet Jesus doesn't respond with frustration and annoyance. How dare you question me? Don't you know who I am? Who are you to think that you, No, he doesn't respond that. He doesn't send back a harsh message to John. He doesn't send back a harsh message to us. We might respond. We might get annoyed, get our back up, and our pride is really wounded. But that's not Jesus. What is Jesus' response? These disciples come. They ask him exactly what John had asked them to ask him. Are you the coming one, or do we look for another? Jesus doesn't say anything at first. Luke tells us that in that very hour, as they're there, they're looking on, they're seeing, they're observing his ministry. He cured many of infirmities, afflictions, and evil spirits, and to many blind, he gave sight. It didn't matter if you came with a long-standing affliction or a more recent illness, he healed you. It didn't matter if you came with physical troubles or spiritual troubles, he healed you. He provided for you. He was undoing the curse of the fall, taking away the effects of sin and the lives of those who came to him. There's a particular emphasis here by Luke on the many blind that Jesus gave sight to. And perhaps this was because there, in some sense, blindness is a picture of both John's need and our need. Because in those moments of doubt, it's like there's a cloudiness that covers our eyes, a film that covers our spiritual sight, so that we're not able to see Jesus as clearly. We're not able to understand things as clearly as we did yesterday or last month or last year. Suddenly, why is it that it all seemed to make sense, and now suddenly it doesn't make sense, or it doesn't, there's some questions. What John needed was to have his eyes not fixed on some past experience, but to be fixed on Jesus. Not even to look just to the works of Jesus, but to be fixed on Jesus himself, the one who did it all. It's a picture of our need, because only Jesus who can help us with our blindness, who can take away that which is blocking our clear sight of him. We need to see Jesus. Jesus demonstrates before he declares. He shows them, this is what I'm doing. But then he follows it up with a declaration. Jesus answered and said to them, go and tell John the things you have seen and heard, that the blind see, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, the poor have the gospel preached to them. He says, here's the message I want you to bring to John. Tell him what you've seen me do. Tell him everything you've seen. You've seen these changes in these lives. You've heard now, it's been affirmed, that the dead that I've raised have actually been raised. It is true, the story that's been told. All this has taken place. And you think the dead having been raised might be the climax. You know, tell John all these things. And then, at the end, tell him, hey, even the dead are being raised. No, that's not the climax. What's the climactic point? That the poor have had the gospel preached to them. The poor in spirit who are empty of any ability in themselves to save themselves, who have come to recognize their emptiness, the ones who are most likely the oppressed of society, those who are cast out and ignored by the religious leaders, are not receiving that spiritual guidance and help that they need. They have the good news of the gospel preached to them, that there is a Savior and he has come into the world to save them from their sins. And they are hearing that message preached. That's the climactic point, John. All of the rest of it points to the truth of the message that's being proclaimed. What is the point of Jesus' demonstration and his declaration? What's the point of it? It's so that John could look to the scriptures and realize this one is fulfilling everything that's been said about the Messiah. We read in Isaiah 35 of what would happen when the Messiah came and how this healing would take place. And John's mind would also have been drawn not only to Isaiah 35, but also to Isaiah 61, which Jesus, and you remember in Luke 4, quoted as he preached in Nazareth and then applied to himself, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. There, it's the first thing. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. And there in Nazareth, Jesus said, today it's being fulfilled. And to John, he's saying, it's being fulfilled, John. Go and tell John, I am he. Go and tell him you're not to look for another. I am the one who was to come, the one who has come. Go and tell John his faith is not misplaced. I am the Messiah. Believe on me. Are you in doubt this morning, wondering, whatever those questions might be, however many they might be plaguing the heart? The answer to your doubt is to look to Jesus Christ and to receive his tender ministry in your own heart. See, this was what he was sending back to John. Not a harsh message with an underlying rebuke, not a passive-aggressive response. Oh yeah, John, you think you're going to question me? Well, here, I'm going to tell you what's what. That's not Jesus. That's not how he ministers to us. In Isaiah 42, there's those comforting words that a bruised reed he will not break and a smoking flax he will not quench. Brothers and sisters, when you doubt and struggle in your faith, Jesus is not looking at you and saying, well, you're partly broken. I'm just going to finish the job and snap you off. Or, hey, you know what? You should be, you're not a roaring flame, so you're just a bit of smoke and the fire is almost out, so I'm just going to cover it with my hands, just pinch it and put it out and be done with you. Cast you off, throw you out, be done. That's not Jesus. That's not your Savior. That's not who he is. That's not what he was to John. You don't need to pretend it's all fine. You don't need to say, no, Lord, everything's great over here. Don't look my way. Don't look into my heart. Don't see the struggles. No, you don't need to pretend, but go to him for help. Go to him with your struggle. Go to him openly. He's not going to hurt you. But he will instruct you. He will strengthen you. He will comfort your heart in the truth of the gospel. You have the scriptures which testify of him. These are they which testify of me, Jesus says, that the Old Testament prophecies and the New Testament revelation perfectly match. They go together, that who Jesus is who God said he would be. And the Spirit of God continues to speak into your heart through the Word of God, that the Word of God is true and real. You can look at the prophecies and say, yes, Isaiah 35 and Isaiah 61 really do match what Jesus looks like. It's not a matter of just intellectual assent. It's that you believe in the Spirit. This is true. The Spirit testifying to your spirit. This is the very Word of God. This is the very Messiah of God. And if you think that I need Jesus in front of me this morning, he needs to take a blind person and open their eyes right in front of me, then I'll believe. Notice this. John didn't have that, did he? Jesus didn't go to Macarius and bring a blind person along and say, hey, John, look through the bars of the window, look through the bars of the cell, and I'm going to show you something. His disciples went back with a firsthand testimony. This is the Messiah. And we, in the Scriptures, preserved by the Spirit of God, have the testimony of the witnesses to Christ. That's tell us, this is the Word of God. This is the Messiah of God. Jesus is the one. We ought not to look for another. John heard, and we can, though it's not stated explicitly, we can understand that John believed. John trusted. Jesus didn't send back a message that would have no effect. Jesus didn't send back, so I'm just going to, maybe this will work. Jesus is the perfect counselor. He's the wonderful counselor. He would have known how to respond. And the Spirit blessed John's spirit. But there is, of course, the question of thinking as you deal with doubts or as you sit here this morning. There are those who doubt, want to be grounded in Christ, want to know, want to be certain. But of course, there are those who hear the Word of God, who hear the testimony of the Scriptures, who hear who Jesus is and simply refuse to believe. There is the reality of a refusal to believe that Jesus is who he says he is. That is demonstrated by a resistance to the teaching. Is this the Jesus I want to follow? I don't think so. I'm going to look and search and stir up. There are many out there who will try to find all these inconsistencies and try to prove the Scriptures aren't true and they're all made up or they've been edited and falsified, although none of that is true. But it's simply from those who want a different kind of God, who want a different kind of Jesus, who want a Jesus of their own imagination, not of the truth of the Scriptures. But what you've heard this morning is the true testimony about who Jesus Christ is. We've heard this morning is the call to forsake your unbelief and to seek Jesus Christ and to seek him alone. There is no other Savior. And to hear the warning of Hebrews chapter 2. How shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation, which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord and was confirmed to us by those who heard him? God also bearing witness both with signs and wonders, with various miracles and gifts of the Holy Spirit, according to his own will. God is testifying, this is my Lord, this is my Messiah, this is the anointed one. He's the one who has come. Hear him, believe him, do not reject him. That's a call to you this morning. If it's not doubt you're dealing with, but outright unbelief and a resistance to the gospel, a resistance to submitting your whole life to Jesus Christ. The testimony is clear. The testimony is sure. Pray for the Spirit to open your eyes. In all your moments of doubt, look to Jesus and His works in order to live in faith. Oh, we've gone from doubt to deliverance. And then Jesus, before He sends these disciples away, He has one final word, a word of blessing for John, a word of blessing for us who believe, who cling to Him by faith. Blessed is he who is not offended because of me. It's an exhortation to live in faith and a blessing that's promised. Blessed is he who is not offended because of me. It is a blessing. God promises to bless us when we believe in the real Jesus, when we believe in the real Messiah. Not in the one we imagined, not in the one we created, not in the one we thought was going to come, but the one that the Scriptures declare was going to come. You know, in Jesus' day, there was a lot of messianic fervor. There were many ideas about who the Messiah was. There were various people who claimed to be the Messiah. There were big ideas that people had in their hearts and minds. Even the disciples struggled through the whole time of Jesus' ministry of truly understanding who the Messiah was and what He was supposed to do. They didn't fully understand. Of course, the humiliated dying on the cross, going to the grave Messiah was not exactly who they imagined. It seemed that very few understood the prophecies in that way. But Jesus, as much as people liked Him, they liked His healing, they liked His teaching, yet He didn't meet the imagination of many. He was not the Messiah many had thought. Where's the Messiah who's going to conquer the Romans and restore the kingdom in Jerusalem and raise up David's throne and sit there and rule over Israel? And perhaps even those like John, who said, where's the Messiah, who's going to bring judgment, who's going to purify Israel, who's going to remove the wicked and establish the righteous? Perhaps that's where John was being tempted to follow some idea of the Messiah that was not conformed to the Scriptures, that was not fully out of the Scriptures, had some truth, because there's always a little truth mixed in to make it believable, but yet was being tempted away. And what Jesus does is He puts him back to the Word. He directs him back to the Scriptures. He directs him back to the inspired testimony of God. And then He blesses those who stand on that testimony, who say, I'm going to stand on the Word of God. Whatever anyone else might say to me about Jesus, about this Messiah, I'm going to stand on the Word of God. And when the Word of God testifies this is the true Messiah, then I am going to align myself with that Messiah. By faith, I'm going to cling to Him and lay hold of Him and not let Him go. And that's what Jesus says. Blessed are you if you're not offended by me, because I'm not the one everyone else thinks I ought to be. I'm not the one everyone else is looking for. When there's only 12, and even then, one falls away. Now there's only 11 who will stay with me. And then they all run away. Now there's only, you know, that Jesus wasn't surrounded by many who believed Him to be the Messiah. There were very few in His time. But Jesus is encouraging those, like John, saying, stay with me, cling to me. You will not be let down. You will receive the blessing of God. Again, are you offended by Jesus this morning? Offended by this idea of the Messiah? We like to, there's this idea, I like to think of God. How I like to think about God is, it's a great statement that starts a lot of heresy. How I like to think about God. We have this idea, this is who Jesus ought to be. This is the Jesus I like. Here's the Jesus, the God of love, and that's really the only characteristic of Him. Or the God of whatever we fit in. Or perhaps, we might not say that so much. I don't know if anyone here this morning is thinking, I just want to create a God of my own existence. Though by our own lives and lives lived, sometimes we can show more than we say. But perhaps there's times we doubt the Father's grace in sending this Messiah. Or the Spirit's power to transform us by the power of this Messiah. Or the salvation that this Messiah has earned and gained for us. We can doubt, did God really say? Does God really mean it? Am I really saved by grace, or do I need to keep adding stuff? Perhaps we question God's love and its sincerity, or His judgment and its severity. We wonder, does it need to be this way? Paul writes that to the Jews that Jesus would be a stumbling block. He was not the Messiah they had imagined in their own minds. Is Jesus a stumbling block for us? The blessing is to believers. The blessing here is to those who believe in this Messiah and no other, who look to him alone and not wait for another one to come. There is that blessing. If you are offended by Jesus this morning and you're not following him and you don't want to do it, come to him. Look to him. Look at who he is. Blessed are those who are not offended by him but believe in him, who repent of that sin and that arrogance and come to believe not in the Jesus of your imagination but in the Jesus of the Scriptures, the promised Messiah. You need him and no other. Brothers and sisters in Christ, as we cling to this Messiah, you can receive this blessing of God. Blessed are those, eternally blessed are you, for clinging to this Messiah, looking to him. There are many offended at Jesus and the message that we are sinners and we need a Savior, and there's only one way of salvation, and it's through believing in Jesus, who had to die on the cross, and and that's the only way to be reconciled to God. Many are offended by all parts of that message. They don't like it. And because we cling to Jesus, they're offended at us too. The finger that gets pointed at Jesus gets pointed at us. There are many who will be offended at you. And there will be times in your own life, and you know this, there are perplexities, wonderings, considerations. What do these things mean in my own life? As we talked about some of these doubts and fears, we might wonder, is this the best way? But what Jesus is saying, he's not promising to give you every answer to every question you ever have. But he's saying, cling to me. Stay with me, believe on me, be encouraged in me, believe the testimony of the Scriptures about me. Here's a sweet and a gentle promise of our Lord, you will be blessed. That is the blessed way to live. When you are not offended, but are resting in me, not led astray, but are staying with me in faith. In all your moments of doubt, look to Jesus and his works in order to live in faith. It's an instruction for us as we hear John's doubt and Jesus' tender reply, where he did not break the bruised reed or quench the smoking flax. You and I will have our doubts and various trials that come to us or in the ups and downs of the mundane Christian living. Sometimes we don't always know. Sometimes it's not a great earthquake that's shaken our lives, but just the ongoing things that come, and we can have our doubts. Perhaps a different outcome than we expected to this situation or that situation. Maybe you're struggling now. Scripture's message is, don't hide, but come to Jesus. Don't pretend, but go to Jesus, and he'll establish you. He will establish you. That's our hope. Go in prayer and seek him. Go to the Scriptures to hear about him and to believe and to be refreshed in faith, and pray for the Spirit to teach and instruct your heart. Believe that promise that blessed, eternally blessed are those who believe and continue to believe and cling to Jesus Christ, the only Messiah, your only hope in life and in death. Amen. Let's pray. Lord our God, we thank you that we don't have to pretend. We thank you that we can be open and honest and deal with the doubts that we have in our hearts that come at times. Not that we always live with doubt, but that there are times and moments and struggles. And each one here, you know what the need of the heart is. And pray that each one would have that openness then to go to you, to seek you in faith, to look to you, knowing you respond tenderly and caringly. You correct and teach and instruct in a manner that is right for your children. So Lord, we pray that would be true here, that we would be able that we would have that confidence in you strengthened and encouraged. Pray for any this morning who are not dealing with doubt but are dealing with outright unbelief, that you would also expose that, open their eyes to see that, bring them to conviction of sin and repentance and belief in this Jesus, this Messiah, this one. For Lord, he is true and trustworthy, and he is the only Savior. So we pray then, and also as we talk to fellow Christians, as we help one another here and other Christians who may be struggling, that we'd be able to point them to the testimony of Scriptures about Jesus. We would pray to them for the comfort and the help of Jesus, and that we would pray also for the Spirit of Christ to lead them into truth and to open their hearts and eyes to see, to be strengthened and encouraged and grow in their assurance. Lord, we thank you for this message of hope, and we pray that you would apply it as needed in our hearts now, and in the days to come. We look to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's sing praise to our Lord Jesus. Hymn 311, Hail to the Lord's anointed. After we receive God's blessing and conclude our time of worship, we will sing hymn 733, Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. That is in your bulletin as well. Receive now God's blessing and go in his peace. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you peace. Go in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.